Then there's communicative listening. And that's when you're communicating. It's basically you're passing back information and sharing. You're collaborating and calculating information. You're passing it back and forth. But then there's deep listening. But for today, I'll call it sympathetic listening. Now the word sympathy has gotten a bad rap. It has. The word sympathy, I don't have sympathy, I have empathy. Well, the word sympathy really just means, it comes from two words, one similar or same, sim, and then the other, pathos, pain. Sympathy really just means that I take on and feel your pain. Are you feeling me? it means you feel the pain of somebody else. It means that what they feel, I feel. It means when they, okay, I'm in the Bible because Romans chapter 12, verse 15 says, when they rejoice, you rejoice. It says, when they mourn, you mourn. You feel their pain. That's why it's hard for a preacher to do a funeral, because you got to feel their pain. That's sympathy. That's the same pathos. And God calls us, if we're going to be friends, to have the same pain that our friends have. We have to feel what? Okay, y'all not feeling me. His name was Booth Tucker. Booth Tucker was a great preacher many years ago. Booth Tucker was, in fact, preaching for the YMCA in Chicago. And while preaching, he was preaching on the sympathy of Jesus Christ and how Jesus Christ can feel our pain and Jesus Christ can carry our load, how Jesus Christ can keep us through any situation and any story. He was preaching that thing. And while he was preaching, he tried to get everyone to agree that God would carry their pain. Well, after the service, Booth Tucker finished preaching. Man came to him and said, you wouldn't talk about Jesus like that if you had been through what I've been through. My wife died, and now the kids keep asking me about her. I don't know what to do. Jesus can't feel this pain. Well, a tragic story, but a teaching story, because a week later, in a train wreck, Booth Tucker lost his wife. And he, in that same sanctuary, was preaching her funeral. And after he preached the funeral, he said, I don't know if he is here today, but I need to let the man know who said that Jesus cannot feel his pain. I'm feeling your pain, and I still declare that Jesus is feeling our pain. Jesus knows about your pain. Jesus cares about your pain, and any pathos that you are passing through, you need to know that Jesus is right there. Ah! Woo! Praise God. You need to know that he is not far from you, but he is with you. He is not distant, but he is dear and near to you. This is what a true friend does. A true friend experiences the same joy and the same downs. And the same. A true friend knows your struggles. First is show up, then it's listen up. But lastly, and I won't keep you long, and forgive me, no disrespect intended, the last thing you got to do is shut up. Don't say it to your neighbor, but you can say it to yourself, shut up. There is a natural tendency to interrogate and evaluate anytime someone's in difficulty. But in our text, it says that they did not speak. Ooh, they did not say a word because the suffering was too great. They didn't say you should have never married him anyway. They didn't say you should have done better by your children. They didn't say you should have managed your money better. They didn't say any of that. They just suffered with him. We all want to give some apostle advice, some preaching protection and proclamation. We all want to give something. I want to tell you, I want to give you peace of my mind. I'm trying to help you. But when people are going through, we have to just shut up. Don't say a word. It's Proverbs 10:19. It says, with a multitude of words comes sin. It's trying to appeal to us to shut up. Don't say anything. Don't say a word. Don't try to even get it. Don't start asking questions. We take the kids in the after school program to visit people in the hospital. And I started crying the last visit we went to. They go to the hospital and they sing three songs in about maybe 5 minutes. Sister Henderson, Mia Henderson, she'll take them and we'll go with. And they sing. I mean, these little kids sing. Boy, they do a good job. Only five of them, but they sing. And this last time I started crying. I started crying because when we initially would take the children to see someone in the hospital. I won't say whose son, but there was a practice of the children would begin to interrogate. They'd say, what happened to you? What happened to your leg? What happened to your eye? I mean, they just begin to interrogate. But this time, they had gone enough, so they knew what to do. They walked in and lined up, and they sang about Jesus, Jesus, oh, what a Jesus, Jesus. And then they went out the room. And the person felt so much better because they didn't need anybody to interrogate. They got doctors to do that. They didn't need anyone to investigate. They just needed somebody to be there with them. And so part of being a friend is knowing when to shut up. Okay, I'll move on. The story is told of a man who was, thank you, praise God, somebody says amen, a man who was passing down the street. And as he was passing down the street next to a mental hospital, he heard a group of people saying, 13, 13, 13. And this was intriguing to the man who was passing by the mental hospital. So he couldn't see over the gate, but then he saw a little hole in the gate. And so he went up to the hole in the gate, tried to peer through, because he wanted to see 13, 13, 13. And he's looking in the hole, and all of a sudden, a stick pokes him in the eye. And they start saying, 14, 14, 14. It's not our job to be the lead investigator. God doesn't need any more Madlocks or Perry Masons. What God needs is some people to be a friend to somebody. And that means we got to shut up. We've got to stop with the tendency to, I got to move on. As I take my seat, I promise you I'm done now. The last thing here in the text that we see is a wonderful relationship that existed where Job was suffering, and in the text that we read, the friends, they wanted to help him up, but they didn't try to pick him up. And I guess I'm confessing now because, you know, as a pastor, sometimes you want to pick people up. You know, you got 10 here sick and 2 over there going through that and 5 over here going through that, and you just want to go pick them up. You know, your heart is, I got to pick them up. And sometimes you say, I can't seem to pick them all up. I can't pick them up. And I was talking to God, and God said, I didn't tell you to pick them up. I didn't tell you to pick them up. I told you to help them up. I said, well, how can I help them up? Forgive me, I'm confessing that. If I cannot pick them up. And God spoke to my heart. And it's in the Bible. I'll show it to you. God said, well, all you have to do is help them to look up. You missed it. Because if they, okay, you missed that. Okay. You missed it. His name is Stanley Milgram. Did I say that right? Stanley Milgram. He did many many experiments. He was a psychologist. He worked at many major universities many years ago. But one of the experiments that he did that isn't as popular is the experiment of looking up. He said, if one person is looking up, then there's a 4% chance that somebody else will come by and look up. But he goes on to say, if there's a group of people, my God, if there's a group of people who are looking up, they're together, right? On the side, can you see them? Looking up. Then what will happen is everybody who passes by will look up. And so what good friends help people do is they keep looking up. So they're looking at you, and then they say, well, what you looking up at? And you say, I'm looking up at God. Because as you look up, they will learn to look up. And when they look up, the Bible told Moses that they had to look and live. When you look up, they'll lift up your heads. Lift up your heads, oh, ye gates, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong. Look up. If you look up and live. If you look up, you'll be lifted up. If you look up, you can get them. And all our job is as a good friend. We can't pick people up, but what we can do is we can keep on looking up. And as we look up, then we'll be placed up. They'll be lifted up. Hallelujah. Praise God. The psalmist said, I will look to the hills from which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be removed. And then I like the psalmist said, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat of my flesh, they stumbled and fell. He goes on to say, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord. And then the text says, and now shall my head be lifted up All it's trying to say to you and me, when you can't pick somebody up, all you have to do is keep looking up and they will join you looking up. And as long as we keep looking up, God will show up in our circumstances. God will show up in our situation. So I'm just looking up. I'm looking at God. I'm looking at his work. I'm looking at his will. I'm looking for the coming of the Lord in my circumstance. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise, I take my seat, I promise you, I'm trying to, hallelujah, praise God. I can't help myself, I went to an HBCU, a historically black college and university, and I enjoyed it. The people were loving, the people were kind, the people were encouraging, but I gotta admit, one of the things that I really loved about the little college I went to, Morrisbound College, is the band would play, and when the band would play at the game, they would do something that was a little bit strange. I'd never seen it before, but what they would do, they'd call it the wave. Yeah, they call it the wave. And so one section, the band would have one section, just stand up, get up, and lift their hands up. And then the expectation was every other section would respond by standing up, getting up, and lifting up their hands. But every now and then, there'd be a section. It might be a section in the low seating or the high seating. It might be the alumni section. I don't know what section it was. It might be a section that fell in or out. I don't know. But one section would just stay seated. And then everybody in the crowd would go, boo. And then the band would play again. And they'd start again. And they'd do it until everybody in the house was standing to their feet, worshiping God. I wish the church was a little bit like that. I wish we could come together. And when people were down, we'd help them stand up, get up, and lift up their hands and just praise God because he's been good. Praise God because he brought us out. Praise God because he's making a way. Praise God. Doesn't matter what section you are. You might be in the hurt section. You might be in the heartache section. You might be in the broke section. You might be in whatever section you are in. Stand up and lift up and get up and raise your hand. Hallelujah. He's worthy. Hallelujah. And I discovered that whenever the wave got going around, somehow whatever was going on the field got better. The team started to score. The running back started to move. The quarterback started to pass because they got up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm so, when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries out. When I think about his protection and his blessing, when I think about how he showed up and made ways for me, when I think about all he's kept me through, when I think about it, my soul gets happy. Hallelujah. Praise God. I think it was about a year ago. About a year ago, we were expecting a baby. About a year ago. And I remember we got some bad news. It was hurtful news. It was tragic news. And my wife looked at me, and I looked at my wife, and we said, well, it's Sunday morning. What are we going to do? We're going to go to church. And we went to church, and we preached, and we praised God, and we went on about our business. And God kept keeping us and kept blessing us, and he turned a frown into a smile. And then a year later, well, amen, and praise God, God has a way of taking your midnights and taking your moments and taking your hurt and taking your heart that's been broken and taking your shame that's been, hallelujah. And he keeps on keeping you. Whatever tragedy, whatever circumstance you've been through, God has a way of turning things around. God has a way of shaking things. God has a way of making the bittersweet. God has a way. Oh, yes, he does. Oh, yes, he does. Oh, yes. God, he'll fix it. God, he's faithful. God, he's able. God will do it. Oh, yes, he will. Oh, yes, he will. Oh, yes, he will. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, he will. I'm not preaching for you. I'm preaching for myself. I promise you, I'm done. Last week, we preached a funeral. And at the end of the funeral, the son of the man who passed on said, Pastor, do you do weddings? I said, yes, I do weddings. You know, I do counseling sessions. He said, well, my family's here from Anchorage, Alaska, from all different places. I really want a wedding today. We had just stepped out of the church. We had just had a funeral. Everybody was crying. I said, well, sir, I would do it, but I can't because you don't have a license. He said, well, young man, my license in the car. I said, well, let's go downstairs and talk. The same crowd that sat through the funeral came back in the sanctuary and set through the wedding. The same crowd that was crying was now laughing. God, he'll turn the bittersweet, he'll turn it around. If you're here today and you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we don't have to wait all day for you. Just come on. You know you need God. You were made for God. You were made for God.